This is in memory of Jared Orchen, and today we're going to learn the Haftorah of Parshat Tetzaveh. It's not the Haftorah of this week, but this is the Haftorah that we are missing in the what we didn't learn yet. But before we go there, we really have to talk about the Haftorah of Parshat Tetzaveh. What are the Parshas? Truma and Tetzaveh are the Parshas that speaks about what? About the building of the sanctuary, right?
Yeah.
Truma and Tetzaveh, then Vayakel and Pekudei. We have four parshas in details, details upon details, repeating itself. Then the Haftorahs are also about it. But if the Haftorah of Parshat Truma is on the Book of Kings describing the first temple, the Haftorah of Parshat Tetzaveh, of this week's parsha, of the parsha, of the Haftorah that we're learning today, it's 1414, page 1414. Is a Haftorah that speaks about, is from the book of Ezekiel. What is Ezekiel speaking about?
The third temple, the future.
Ezekiel is speaking about the future, not about the past. The future temple. Now, what is the most important piece of furniture in the temple?
The ark. The table.
Table, the ark. Any other opinion?
Huh?
The menorah.
There's only the.
That doesn't make sense, huh?
Yeah.
You have the, anything else?
Well, you've got the thing that held the challah.
The altar.
The altar, maybe.
The yeah. Incense.
The incense. You see what's going on here? The cherubs. What are we doing?
The whole. It's not furniture.
Huh?
I was going to say whatever the Holy of Holies, but it's not furniture.
That's the ark.
The ark, right.
Then what is the most important piece of the furniture in the temple? The question is, what's the focal point of the temple? And let's look at some things. In Parshas Truma, we need to learn that soon in the Torah, wouldn't be a bad idea to look at it. Page 513. The Torah speaks about the first thing we're going to build me a temple. They should make me a sanctuary and I will dwell among them, right? What the first thing that God speaks about?
The ark.
The ark. He didn't speak about the temple yet. Where is the property? How much acres should we build it? Drawings of a building. Gunished. Build me an ark. That's from this you learn. The ark is the most important thing. And you know who says it? Your friend. You know who's your friend? Nachmanides. That's his friend. If you look on page 513 in the classic question, the last of the classic questions there, why does the Torah
describe the ark before we have learned about the tabernacle itself?
Mm-hmm.
Ramban.
That's Nachmanides.
Yes.
Yeah.
The ark is the primary component of the tabernacle, since that is where the divine presence rested. Therefore, the Torah describes the ark in its lid first.
Okay. According to Nachmanides, the ark of the covenant is the most important part of the temple, and that's why it's like you come to the architect and you tell him, you know what, especially when you come with your wife, we need a sunroom. Says, so where are you buying a building a house? I don't know, I don't care, we need a sunroom. You know, when I came to the architect to build my house, I told him, we need to build a sukkah, a permanent sukkah. He asked me, what are you talking about a sukkah now? We don't have a house, we don't have that. I needed a sukkah, that's it. You come to build a temple, God says, you know what, I really want an ark. That's it, starts with an ark. That's Nachmanides' opinion. But maybe, when they build the second temple, how they started? What they built first? Anybody remember?
Built first, out of the altar.
They built the altar first. And they got stuck with the altar for a long time before they really had a building.
That's the functional part, you know.
Is the ark dependent on the temple or not? What do you think?
No.
Ark's mobile went into the exile.
It, right?
it wasn't in the desert.
The ark was before the temple, right? How we know that? We know that from end of Parshas Kisiso. Moses on page 583, Moses came down from Mount Sinai, right? And it was number 29, for example, on Yom Kippur.
On Yom Kippur, Moshe came down from Mount Sinai, and the two tablets of the testimony were in Moshe's hand when he came down from the mountain. Moshe did not know that the skin of his face had become radiant while God had spoken with him. Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moshe, and look, the skin of his face had become radiant, and they were afraid to come near him.
And Moses is coming down from Mount Sinai. Remember the story on Shavuos, God gave, said the Ten Commandments. Then Moses went up for 40 days. Then he came down with the first set of tablets and he saw the golden calf. He broke the golden calf. He broke the tablets. He went back up for another 40 days. Then a third set of 40. Finally, on Yom Kippur, he comes down with the last 40, with the second set of tablets. He had to put it somewhere. He had the ark. Nobody actually saw the tablet, by the way, the second time. No one. He sneaked into the camp. He came in quietly, nobody heard about that, because the first time was a big stink, and it was the eye in the red, it was the evil eye, that God said the second time, shh, nobody should know. The Jews, whenever they talk too much about something, the only problems. Come in, sneak it, they put it in an ark. Before it was a temple, only the next day, Moses told the Jewish people, God said to build me a sanctuary, to build me a sanctuary. And that was Yom Kippur. When was the inauguration of the sanctuary?
No. It was Nisan.
Rosh Chodesh Nisan, 2 weeks before Pesach, 6 months later. Then the ark was before the temple. The ark was later, they took the ark in the stories and the prophet. The whole Indiana Jones movie is based on what? That they took the ark to war and it was confiscated by the Philistines, and it came back and it was in different places. There's nothing wrong. And the ark of the covenant, the temple is destroyed, the ark is somewhere. According to Maimonides, it's in the tunnels underneath the temple. According to other opinions, it was taken away in exile. But it's somewhere. Means the ark can survive without the temple. There's many laws about it. Then the ark, on one end, yes, the ark is the focal point of the temple. It's in the Holy of Holies. It's the holiest part of the temple. If you go by holiness of the part of the temple, you know, there is a Mishnah that says there is 10 levels of holiness inside in the world. Israel is holier than the rest of the world, right? Everybody agrees. Within Israel, cities are walled cities. That's called walled cities from the time of Joshua. Are holier than the rest of Israel. Within the walled cities, the walled city, Jerusalem, is holier than the other walled cities. Within Jerusalem, the Temple Mount. Within the Temple Mount, there is also a few levels. All the way to the Holy of Holies, that's the holiest part of Israel, of the world. Then from this point of view, the Ark of the Covenant is the focal point of the temple, Aaron HaBrit. But it could be without the temple.
And it could be a temple without the ark. That's a whole second temple.
Very good. It could be a temple without the ark. The second temple did not have an ark, and it was a temple.
Although the prevailing thought is that it was beneath. So
doesn't
that
make a difference. The bottom line is, inside the temple, there was no ark. You're right. There, what you say?
But wait, I have a question then.
Yeah.
The second temple is where a lot of the priests went in and didn't make it. They didn't come out. Isn't that the second temple?
Even without the ark.
No ark.
Aha! Finally clicked, huh?
They would spend money to go in there and see if
there was no ark inside. Yes, but it was the presence of God. It was the dome of the rock. Some rock. Ich weiß nicht which rock, but the rock was there. If it's the dome of the rock, or the other rock, it was a rock then. I wouldn't swear that this is the same rock, but it was a rock then. But the second temple survived without the ark. Obviously, not necessarily the ark is the ultimate goal of the temple. Maimonides says that the purpose of the temple is to offer sacrifices there. And what do you offer sacrifices?
Altar.
The altar. Can the altar be without a temple?
Yeah, the beginning of the second temple. Mm-hmm. They started with just an altar. Right?
Any more examples for this?
Egypt. Didn't they have an
Egypt
altar?
What?
In Egypt. In Alexander, there was a... They built something...
Oh, you're talking about...
Mount Carmel?
No, don't go there. You're going the wrong direction.
Mount Carmel. Okay.
Completely, huh?
Mount Carmel.
Mount Carmel, there was an altar without... It was a temporary order.
Thing.
It was an executive order from the president. What, any better examples?
Speaking right now.
Don't worry, you'll never repeat it. You'll hear from it.
That's why
I promise you. Where was altars without a temple?
Abraham's time.
Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Noah. According to the Medrash, Adam and Eve, was an altar without a temple.
The same place then.
That's a Medrash. Not so simple, the same place. There were a few. Jacob was running around. We built altars in a few places. Not necessarily that. Now, the altar is not only, Maimonides puts it for the purpose of sacrifices, but there were altars who were not for sacrifices either. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob built altars. They never sacrificed on it. The only time they offered a sacrifice is?
Noah.
That's Noah. About the forefathers.
Isaac
was a sacrifice.
Isaac, and instead Isaac was not in then.
Instead of Isaac, the ram was the ram.
The only time. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob built a cube like maybe 7 times. They never offered anything. They pulled oil. They were...
Vegans.
Vegans. Thank you. They don't touch animals, no. Loving people. By the way, when Moshiach will come, not necessarily that in the Holy Temple will actually run around and slaughter animals. There's a discussion about it. Could be there will be a little oil. It will be the modern world. If not, the FDA, whatever it's called, will come and close us down. I mean... But the altar is also a piece of furniture that could be without the temple, but more connected to the temple, much more. I mean, in a temple, you have an altar. Can you imagine a temple without an altar, for example? No. A temple without an ark was. A temple without an altar, then what's the point of the temple? You understand what I'm saying? If you cannot offer sacrifice, that's not the holy temple or a time to offer sacrifices, morning and evening. Then we have, and where we see that the altar is a piece of furniture on its own, without a temple, from where it's coming, this idea that they started to build the altar without a temple, is coming from the Bible. In Parshas Yitro, right after the Ten Commandments, first thing that God is so busy to tell us after the Ten Commandments. It's on page 475. Yeah, 475. Right after the Ten Commandments. Go ahead, Rick.
Under which one? Yeah. Which
19, 20, 21.
Okay. God said to Moshe, say the following to the children of Israel. You have seen that from the skies I have spoken with you, and I have shown my fire and might down on earth. You shall not make images of any of my spiritual servants that are with me. You should not make the cherubs from silver.
You see, it's a lot of parentheses. Basically, do not make images, right? Really, he said it in the first of the Ten Commandments. I don't know why he repeats it again, but that's a different question. Then go number 21. You have your number 21? That's next page. Next page, number 21.
You shall make for me an altar attached to the earth, alternatively filled with the earth, and you shall slaughter near it your burnt offerings and your peace offerings, which come from your sheep and your cattle.
God gives a commandment, you should make me an altar. Right after Mount Sinai, before he ever said about a word about building a temple, before anything. Before he said Good Shabbos, before anything. Build me an altar. And what? Continue.
Wherever I allow my name to be mentioned, i.e. only in the holy temple by priests, I will come to you and bless you.
Mm-hmm. Continue. Also strange.
Okay. Continue. When you make for me an altar of stones, you shall not build them of cut stones, lest you wield your sword upon it and desecrate it by using an object of death to form the altar, which is an object of life. When you build a ramp to my altar, do not make it ascend with steps, so that it will not look as if your nakedness is exposed.
Okay, you tell me why God doesn't want steps to the altar? First of all, what is the altar? What is the emergency about the altar right after Mount Sinai?
No wonder.
I have a lot of more important things to tell to the Jewish people beside the altar. He writes next parasha starts about the loss of slaves and the loss of charity and be nice and be a mensch and don't beat up your friend. Build me an altar. And by the way, do not put some steps. First of all, the place for the order of building an altar is strange. Right away. Obviously, there is an urgency here. Number two, why not to build steps for the altar? Why not?
Apparently, as with King David, when he was dancing around, some people did not wear loincloths.
And because King David dancing around, therefore we should not build steps.
No, that's to show his nakedness. Sort of,
what nakedness? People were wearing pants.
Robe, they wear a robe.
Well, yeah. First of all, the priest were wearing the Israelite michnasayim, right? I'll show you, they wore pants. I have a proof that they were wearing pants. Whatever the pants means, here it is. So it's a big decadish. See it? Okay, here it is. Page 545.
Number 3, it says the robe.
Yeah, but there is not only robes. They had robes too, I agree. But they also had number 42. Make for them linen.
Tunics.
No, 42.
Yeah.
545, number 42.
545.
Michnasay.
Make
okay.
Michnasay, right? Read it in English, Mark.
Make for them linen pants to cover the flesh of their nakedness. They should reach from the waist down to the thighs. So that's coverage. That
something was there. I have a better question for you. Let's say they were wearing only robes. Let's say it's not nice for them. First of all, it's an amazing thought. Rashi brings it here. They couldn't wear pants. They cannot expose their nakedness. To whom? To the stones.
Right.
What are you talking about? Stones. Not anybody there. Rashi says from the Talmud, look what a lesson we can learn from it. If stones who do not feel and do not see and do not be insulted, you're not allowed to insult them. Your friend that is in the image of God and is being insulted, how much more you have to be careful not to insult. That's a lesson, by the way. But I have a better question. Shine, let's say they were. It was about not exposing themselves. There were steps in the temple, or there were no steps in the temple?
Your steps.
Yeah, the Levites sang on the steps, didn't they?
The Levites sang on the steps. Any other examples? There was more steps in the temple. To go light up the menorah, there were 3 steps. In front of the menorah, there were 3 steps. And the menorah was not so tall. You really didn't need steps on the menorah. The menorah was like this, this height, I think. And there were 3 steps. And there were 15 steps that the Kohens used to bless the congregation. Inside, The temple mount was full of steps. It was a mountain full of steps built in. Comes to the temple, to the ark, to the altar, no steps. I have this question forever and ever and ever. Why no steps?
Didn't they have to also carry the animals up to the
steps? They had to carry the animals. The animals were very heavy.
Maybe it's easier.
Without steps. It's really, first of all, the ramp was very, very steep. Unbelievably steep, like this, like almost. You had to be very strong. They used to pour a lot of salt that people shouldn't slip. That's what's written. It took a lot of strength to run up the ramp to the temple, to the altar. It wasn't handicapped accessible like today, that they have to be there's a certain... I remember when I was made it with a builder, we made a calculation. It was like this, literally, very, very hard to go up. Would be much easier with the steps. That's just why it's here. Number one, why not steps? But the question is, what is the ark, what is the altar representing? What's the ark representing, and what's the altar representing?
The ark is God's throne.
The ark is God what?
God's throne on earth, so to speak, with a Shekinah.
But it's also it's his ratzon, it's his will, his...
The ark! What?
Footstool.
Footstool? The whole world is a footstool.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a doim ragla.
Well, it says well, he's going to dwell amongst the people.
Among us.
Amongst everyone.
You know, we go every Shabbos to shul. There is the Torah, reading the Torah, and there is the prayers. The Torah is what God tells us. The prayers, we speak to God. It's a conversation going on. Really, that's the two differences between the Ark and the altar. The Ark is the Torah, what God gave us. God came down at Mount Sinai, and he gave us the Torah. He did his job, and he's done. Now, our job is the altar. What's the job of the altar?
Connect back up.
To offer sacrifice, to go up.
It's the equivalent of prayer.
Equivalent of prayer.
What do you do today?
Exactly. That's our job. That the altar really represents Mount Sinai. And Mount Sinai, what's Mount Sinai? We have to go up to Mount Sinai. We have to go up to, you know what, maybe Mount Moriah, where Abraham was offering Isaac as a sacrifice. It's an interesting point to realize, Mount Sinai is not a holy mountain, right? God gave the Torah, he finished the job, it's a regular mountain. Not expensive real estate. Mount Moriah is a holy site forever. Why? God came down by himself with us and gave the Ten Commandments, and the mountain was shivering and moving, and there it was. Mount Sinai, everything stands and falls on Mount Sinai. What happened to Mount Moriah? Abraham wanted to sacrifice Isaac. There was no revelations, and was no fire, and the mountain was not trembling, nothing. But he was ready to sacrifice. That's why it's a holy mountain. What I am ready to do, not what God did. That the altar represents Mount Moriah, Mount Sinai, a mountain that we have to climb up closer to God. A mountain does not have steps. And a mountain you climb. You go higher and higher and higher. A mountain is not your proper. Regular mountain. Any mountain you see it. Mount Tabor, any mountain, Mount Carmel, there's no steps. Yeah, over the years somebody made steps, but a mountain is you climb it. That's why the altar is no steps, because the altar represents the mountain that we have to climb, get closer to God. Mi yaleh be'ar Hashem, who will climb in the mountain of God? It's a mountain you have to climb. You have to offer sacrifice. You have to give to God. Then what is the focal point of the temple? Depends from which point, from where you're looking at. If you look from God's point of view, so to speak, God is the Ark of the Covenant. God's presence is more stronger when we have the Ark of the Covenant. But if you think at the temple as a place for us to get closer to God, it's the altar. in Chabad, there is the Rebbe's, there was a Maimer. A Maimer is a Hasidic discourse that a Hasidic Rebbe used to say in every week, the one that the Rebbe said when he became Rebbe was the last one that the previous Rebbe finished, the last one of his life. And it's talking about making, we spoke about it a few times, there are seven tzaddikim who brought down the Shekhinah down to earth. And let's start from the beginning. When God created the world, he revealed himself on earth. He was very tangible. Adam and Eve came down. That was godliness. Then what they did? They ate on the tree of knowledge. Then what they really did? They denied God. They chased away God to the first heaven. You know, there are seven heavens? Then the Medrash goes, then came Hanoch, the next generation, and did another sin and chased God away to the higher heaven. And a third generation, and a fourth generation, the generation of the flood, and the generation of the Tower of Babel, and so on and on. They pushed God away to the seventh heaven. Then came Abraham, and he started to bring down God back to earth. What means he brought down God back to earth? He made the world recognize that there is a God. That Abraham started, that the Medrash puts that Abraham brought God from the seventh heaven to the sixth heaven. And Isaac from the sixth heaven to the fifth heaven. And Jacob to the fourth heaven. And Levi, Jacob's son, to the third heaven. And Chaos, Levi's son, to the second. And Amram to the number one. And then came Moses, the seventh one. And he actually brought the Shekhinah down to earth. Where he brought the Shekhinah down to earth?
Mount Sinai.
Beautiful. Very nice. That was Moses did. Now the job is, what is our job? Is to build a temple for God and offer sacrifices. What means to offer sacrifice? To sacrifice. What means sacrifice? You know, how you say in Hebrew sacrifice? What is Korbanot. Korban comes from the word karov. Leit karev. What means leit karev?
To get near. Close.
Get closer. Yeah, get near. God doesn't need your fat, your animal. Korban, to get closer, to sacrifice on yourself to God. Get a little closer to God. That now our job is to alter. Since Mount Sinai, God, Moses brought down the Torah to her, and we have to go closer to God. Now it's our job. Now it's our turn. That's the altar. That's why the altar is really the focal point of the temple. More than the ark. The ark is God's presence here. And there is a discussion in the Talmud, in Rashi, where is God speaking to the Jewish people? Where is the point inside the all in the temple? You remember, where is God speaking?
Between the cherubs.
Between the cherubs. In the Mishkan. Yeah. I think there is a Rashi. It says somewhere, I don't remember where and what, but somewhere it says that God, one opinion says he did it by the altar, and one opinion says he did it between the cherubs. Mm-hmm. That means the two sides of it, you understand? Where is God revealing to people? On these tombs? Or when we sacrifice ourselves? And now we know that the ark, that the altar is a very important part. Now we are going to learn the Haftorah of Parshat Tetzaveh. Because the Haftorah of Parshat Tetzaveh is really a very technical Haftorah. But the importance of it is that it speaks mainly about the altar, not about the ark. It's from Ezekiel chapter 43. 14, 14, yeah. Ezekiel chapter 43 starts from number 10. From verse number 10, and it goes on. Then let's read a little bit and we'll see what he can make out of it. Your son
of man, describe the house which you saw in a vision to the house of Israel, so that they will be reminded of the temple that was destroyed, and they will be ashamed of their inequities which caused the destruction. Let them think in their hearts the dimensions of the future house which is ready to be built.
There's a very strange thing, this whole story. Ezekiel really lived at that time.
In Babylon.
Ezekiel is in Babylon, in New York City. And he speaks about building a temple. Building a temple. They just got an order from Jeremiah to do what?
Listen to the surrender to the Babylonians.
Settle in Babylon, get married, have children, build homes, and listen to and pray for the good of the government of Babylon. Right? On the other hand, Ezekiel comes and tells him, "No, we're going to build a temple. It's going to be this building, this size, and this temple. What temple? When temple? Why God told them go and talk to him about a temple? What's the point?
Bad things were happening, and this is hope for the future, obviously.
Just to give them hope for the future. Let's read. If you see on page 14, 15, number 10, the note." Corey, you want to read the note number 10?
Describe the house?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, please.
Which you saw in a vision to the house of Israel. The Midrash relates Ezekiel's response to this command. Ezekiel said to God, "Right now we are in a state of exile in the land of our enemies, and you are telling me to go inform the Jewish people of the dimensions of the temple, to write it before their eyes, to guard its measurements and laws. Is there anything that they can do about it? Leave them until they come out of exile, and then I will go and inform them."
Ezekiel said, "What do you want from the poor Jews? I'm going to tell them about building a temple? They can do anything about it, they're in exile. You told them to stay in exile, then what do you want from them? Why to drive them crazy? That's the question. Why to drive the Jews crazy? Here is the candy, but you cannot have it. Why? What is it? God said to him, continue.
God said to Ezekiel, Yechezkel, mm-hmm. "Should my house be neglected because my children are in a state of exile?" God said to him, "Reading about it in the Torah is as great as building it. Go and tell them to read the design of the temple in the Torah, and in reward for reading it, for busying themselves with reading it, I will consider it as if they are busying themselves with
next page, with the building.
With building the temple.
Mm-hmm.
This is the basis for the popular custom, which has been practiced now for many years, to study the design of the temple during the 3 weeks when we mourn the destruction of the temple, 17th Tammuz to 9th of Av.
Mm-hmm.
For at a time of the year when the temple's destruction is more stressed, the need for its correction by rebuilding the temple also needs to be stressed."
And what is the Midrash laying a foundation in? There is an amazing totem. Talking about the temple is building it. That explains another question. But I'll give you first an example. Your child is out of town. How much you talk about them? A whole day. And he's next to you. You don't want to look at him. Isn't this strange? When he's in town, you have no clue. Where is your son? I don't know. When he's out of town, you know every step. He went there and he did this and then. And your child tells you, "When I'm home, you never drink me a cup. Where I go? What do you care where? He's out of town. You want to know every move he made." Not having him, talking about them, fills the void of him not being here. That's why you're talking about. You understand? You know, we have so much written about the temple. 4 parshas, I think 186 verses or something, like ridiculous numbers of verses talking about the temple. Again and again and again and again, the same thing. The mitzvah of tefillin, how to make tefillin, is not written in the Bible. Put it between your eyes, a good Shabbos. How are you going to do it? Ask your father. You should ask his teachers, and his teacher ask Moses. It's not written. All the kosher, the laws of kosher, how to slaughter an animal, it's not written. You should slaughter it as I told you. You look everywhere, as I told you, it never told them. It told them, but it's not written. Why is the Torah going in such great details about the temple? That most of the years was never even used. That's the answer. Because it was never used. The way we fulfill the building of the temple is by talking about it. That's why we have Truma and Tetzave and Vayakel and Pekudei and again and again and again. Because we talk about it instead of building it. That's our way to build it, so to speak. Build it in world, in the world of world. That God tells Ezekiel, yeah, in exile, I want him to talk about the temple. Talking about it is doing it when you cannot do it.
What, isn't there a Talmudic something that talks about in every generation, if you don't build a temple or something?
It's like you destroyed it. It's a different point.
That's not a good point.
I know, thank you. But that's not this point.
This is good.
Then what lays behind it? But there is more to it. God tells you, you're in Babylon. Let me go to do business. Let me listen to the news. Let me live a life. God said, no. You're in Babylon, but in your mind, you should be in Jerusalem. That's another important thing. God never let us Jews enjoy life. Simple as that. He wants you to be in one place and think about another place. If you're all day in the synagogue, God tells you, what are you doing in the synagogue all day? Go to work. But if you get too excited about work, he says, oh, what are you getting so excited about work? You should think about you want to be in shul. That he wants you to be at work, but to want to be in shul.
Didn't you once say he's asking us for the impossible?
Exactly.
What does that mean?
I will explain you. God doesn't want all the Jews to be necessarily in the land of Israel, because if he want to, we would be there. Simple. Obviously, he does want us. But he wants us three times a day to pray for it, to long, to want to be in Israel. I want you in exile, but don't get comfortable. You're in Babylon, but what you should talk about building the temple in Israel? What temple? When temple? The country is controlled by the Babylon. The country is desolated. There is nothing there. It's not even a dream. I want you to dream about Jerusalem. To be in one place and to want to be in another place. That's what we want from a Jew. God wants the Jew to be in the most physical world, but to want to be in a spiritual place. If we will be a holy Yom Kippur in the synagogue, nothing will be accomplished. God wants us to go out to work, to the workplace and to deal with life. But where you really, if you ask the staff, the Jew in the middle of the day, if we would get the places you wish, where you wish to be, I wish to be now learning Torah. That's what we wish. But if he runs to the Koilel, to Jerusalem, to learn Torah all day, God says, I'll ask you to go to Koilel all day, who is going to fix the world? Then God wants from us the impossible. To be in one place and to want to be in another place. It's almost like we human beings are constantly. Before the vacation, you think about the vacation. And the vacation, you think about after the vacation. After the vacation, you remember the vacation. You never where you are. But that's anyway the nature of people. But you should do it in the right way. It means to say a person should have the longing to be in a more spiritual place. Always the eyes above, for them. Yeah, I'm here because I have to be here. I have to make a living. There's this famous story about a Hasidic Jew that he had a business, a boot business, galoshes. You know what galoshes is, right? He comes in to the one of the Chabad Rebbe, he started to tell him about business and this. Finally, the Rebbe gives a look at him and told him, you know, I saw people putting their feet in the galoshes, but they added the galoshes. I never saw such a thing. He kind of told him, you're all consumed with your business. Forget it, there is life above the water. There is something more important than your galoshes. There is a God, there is a Torah, there is learning, there is service. There is more important things. Then we have to have the foot in the galosh. You have to have a business, and you have to do what you're supposed to do. But where you really want to be? It's like, you know, people have a hobby that that's they never have a free time. They do it. They write or they write a paper or they something that we're really enjoying about. He has to go to work because this doesn't give him a living. You know, not everybody can make a living being a rabbi. You know, but. Ask him what he wants to do. Every free moment he's doing the other thing. Because that's a really enjoy. That's what God is giving us. That's why God tells Ezekiel, you talk to them about the temple. In their mind, they're in Jerusalem. Physical bodies are in Babylon. I know exactly where they are. Because they're in Babylon, I need them to dream about Jerusalem. When they're in Jerusalem, I don't need them to learn about the temple. They're in the temple. But we are in Babylon, they better dream about Jerusalem. If not, they'll forget altogether about Jerusalem. And that's the whole idea of the Parshas in the Torah and the Zaftah. That's what Ezekiel's agenda was. And that's why we mourn the destruction of the temple. It's all about keeping the Jew above the water. He shouldn't sink in the mud of the daily life. He should always have a dream. You know, the Rebbe used to say many times that a Jew is a dreamer. See, Joseph was dreaming and Jacob was dreaming. Jewish people are always dreaming for a better future. That's why the Jewish people want to change the world. What is dreaming of a better future? It means not giving up. It means I'm not really here. I have a dream. I'm not doing good. I have a dream. We all have dreams. Okay, now we learn a little bit from inside. Just we shouldn't, you know, we open the book. So we have to read it from inside. Number 11, I think.
If they are ashamed of all that they have done, which caused the destruction of the temple, describe to them the general form of the house, its detailed layout, its exits and its entrances, its dimensions of each room, its laws regarding the use of each room, all its sculptured decorations, all its regulations regarding where the priests and the people may stand. Write all this for them to see so that they may remember its whole form and all its regulations, so that they will merit to be resurrected in the future and fulfill them.
It means to say like this. That's in parentheses, the resurrected business. But it means to say, if you dream about the temple, you will be there.
To quote a recent movie, yeah. Build it and they shall come.
Oh, yeah. That's what people don't mean when you start to build a show. A little bit short to it, though. Okay, you want to...
Don't know
14:15 in top of the page now. Top of the page 14:15. In top of the page in the English.
This is the last.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
The top of the mountain, its entire border around it shall be most holy. Behold, this is the law of the house. These are the measurements of the altar in cubits. The holy cubit used in temple measurements is a regular cubit of 5 hand breadths. Plus an extra hand breadth, making a total of 6. The height of the base shall be a regular cubit, and the width a regular cubit, and each of its border horns all around shall be a hand breadth from its center to its edge. The regular cubit shall also be used to measure the side of the golden altar. From the base on the ground to the top of the lower block shall be 2 cubits, and then a width of 1 cubit. From the top of the small block to the top of the large block shall be 4 cubits, and then a width of 1 cubit. The upper part of the altar shall be 4 cubits high. From the upper part of the altar upward shall be 4 horns.
Okay, now you know how to build the altar, right? It's basically built like almost like a tower. It's wider in the bottom, getting smaller, and it goes in, and the Kohens were able to run around the altar to be able to offer the sacrifices. It made like steps that should have space to stand on.
Is there a substantial difference? I know there are differences in the temples, different 1 and 2 and so forth.
Actually,
so the
altar in the second temple was built basically according to Ezekiel's book. Similar, very
well,
similar.
Because they took pieces from...
Yeah, because when they built, it's interesting. Ezekiel wrote his description before the second temple. That when they built the second temple, they knew already it's not what Ezekiel envisioned. Also, the many pieces of Ezekiel is not, nobody understands exactly how to do it. They leave it for Elijah. That from a practical point of view, they couldn't do it either. But the altar it's written is very similar to what Ezekiel... described.
How is it
and
different
could
from
be,
the first?
It could be also, because that was the beginning of the building, they were closer to the time of Ezekiel, they were more trying to be going according to his directions. Where later there was a stop in the building of the temple, and when later they got permission to build a temple, they said, just build a temple, forget about how and what. Number 16.
The burning area at the top of the altar part shall be 12 cubits long by 12 cubits wide, perfectly square on its sides. The entire block shall be 14 cubits long by 14 wide on its four sides. The horns around its edges shall be half a cubit. Its base shall be a cubit around. Its ramp shall be arranged so that a person ascending it faces the east.
Okay, now we know a little more. Continue. Mr. Olgin?
He said to me, Son of man, this is what God Almighty says. These are the laws of inaugurating the altar on the day when they shall finish making it, to make it fit to offer burnt offerings on it, and to sprinkle blood on it. You will be resurrected, and you shall give to the priests who are from the tribe of Levi, who are descendants of Tzadok.
Tzadok. Why descendants of Tzadok?
He was the priest loyal to King David.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And according to Ezekiel, the priesthood then runs with that line.
Exactly. And who was Tzadok? Who was he? The son of whom? From which lineage he came from? Pinchas. In the beginning, Pinchas was not. See, there in the coins itself, any coin? Oh. Two. In the coins itself, which there is a few dynasties, Tzadok was the priest that was loyal to King David. When it was who made a revolution against King David? Absolutely. It's Aftoa. Absolutely. Yeah, but this was not Absalom's revolution. That was Adoniah ben Hagit, you remember? Yes. Adoniah in the Aftorah from Parshas Vayera, from Parshas Chayisor. If you look on page 1382, there is a story about King David being very old, and Adoniah is trying to make a revolution and to appoint himself as a king. And he called to his side, he mobilized to his side Joab and Neviata, and they helped him. But we didn't call, number 8 on page 1382, we didn't call.
But Tzadok, the priest, Benayahu, son of Jehoiada, Nasan, the prophet, Shimi, Ra'i, and David's strong men, Elazar, Adino, and Shama, were not with Adoniyahu, for they remained loyal to David.
They remained loyal to David. Ay, 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 ay. And then they went to David and they told them that you, they asked him like, that you told us that Adoniyah should be the king. And David said, I never said such a thing. Then Tzadok, the priest, was loyal to the king. Yeah. Right? And he says it again on page 1384, turn the page, 1384, right on top of the page, number 26, and?
Okay, 26.
And he did not
invite me, Tzadok the priest, Benayahu, son of Jehoiada, nor Shlomo, your servant.
This he didn't invite. Basically, Tzadok the priest was not a part of the revolution, of the rebellion against King David. Therefore, he married it. Ezekiel talks, how many years later? 500 years later. That the children of Tzadok are the priests to be in the temple. The other ones were out. The other priests. Where there is another Aftorah, Akoyanim Alevim Bnei Tzadok. Where is the Aftorah?
Ezekiel 44, but I'm not sure.
Here it is. On page 1439, you'll see another Aftorah starts. From Ezekiel 44, very good, yeah. Very, very good. Go ahead.
Where are we?
The priest, the beginning of the Aftorah of Emor.
The priests who are from the tribe of Levi, the descendants of Tzadok, who kept the watch of my sanctuary in the times of Shlomo, even when the Jewish people strayed from me, they will draw near to me to serve me.
And they will stand before me to offer me fat and blood, says God Almighty.
This says Ezekiel about the third temple, about the Moshiach will come. Who is going to be there? Which, from which family of a priest will be entrusted to the temple?
Tzadok.
From Tzadok. Why? Because he was loyal to me when? By King David and Solomon. And that's what he's talking here in the parash of this week, in the after of this week, that we are talking in after of the Sava. We're speaking about the because what happened is, just a little bit more information, history. Tzadok is a descendant of Pinchas. Mm-hmm. Pinchas was the guy who killed Zimri, right?
Zimri, yes.
Pinchas, you see, Aaron was the high priest, right? The first high priest. Aaron had four sons, Nadav and Avihu, Eleazar and Itamar. And when Aaron became a priest, he and his four sons became a priest, and anybody will be born later. Pinchas was the first grandson who was born before that. That he fell between the cracks. He wasn't a Kohen in the beginning. God says, I'm making Aaron and his four sons to be Kohens. And if they have any children in the future, the children will be Kohens. Was one grandchild already available, already alive? His name was Pinchas. He wasn't a Kohen. Shame, you know, you were not on the list. What should we do? He wanted to appoint you. The transition team wanted to make it. It wasn't the boss, no?
It was a carryover from the Obama administration.
Exactly. He told them to fire himself. He didn't want to. It was. Then what happened? Then Pinchas got up. It was a story with Zimri, mm-hmm. a Jewish man from the tribe of Shimon went out with a Midianite girl, came to Moses, says, "Why cannot marry the Midianite girl?" Moses says, "You can't." He says, "And Moses and you could marry a Midianite girl. I can't." Kitzer, Pinchas got angry, got up, and he killed Zimri, right? Mm-hmm. God came out to testify, did it for the sake of God, and he told them, "Because this, I'll give you a present. You'll become a Kohen." Mm. All nice and fine and dandy, but the Jews didn't like it. You're going around killing people here on the street? What is this? The biggest tzaddik in town, Moses didn't kill him, Aaron didn't kill him, not Eleazar and Itamar didn't kill him. You? What's it does? That until the story of Solomon, I think the family of Pinchas, I remember the Medrash right, they were not really serving, they were not the accepted family. You understand? It was the children, because Eleazar took over after even that Pinchas took over, was something there was not right for many generations. And because Tzadok was loyal to King David, they became the in family throughout the first temple, and for the future also, and Moshiach will come. And that's why he mentions Tzadok. Where are we? Number 19, on page 14, 15, that's for sure. Yeah, we are number 20, I think. 14, 15, number 20.
I'm still fine.
Okay, go ahead.
14, 15, what, 20?
20.
Right, here?
Yeah.
He shall take some of its blood and put it on the altar's four horns and on the four corners of the top block and on the surrounding base. With this act, you will cleanse and purge it of its prior non-holy identity. You also shall take the bull of the sin offering, and it shall be burnt by someone at the extremity of the house outside the sanctuary. On the second day, you shall offer a male goat.
Okay, now, you talk about means on the second day. He's speaking about the inauguration of the temple when Moshiach will come. It's very similar to the inauguration of the temple that took place in the desert, 7 days. And the same thing was the first temple, when they inaugurated the first temple by King Solomon. It was a 7-day celebration, maybe even more, but for sure 7 days. Go ahead.
Question before we get there. This concept of we'll continue to have sin offerings in the future. To what extent is that controversial?
No,
Maimonides agrees. We're going to have all offerings are coming back, but then Maimonides has other commentary basically saying, well, the basic reason for offerings are to wean people away from idolatry. But if we're not going to be idol worshippers at that point, then is there...
Didn't we mention that in the beginning, that it's not clear if you're going to be sacrifices or not? There is a bigger question. You're talking about sin offerings? Who's going to do sins when Moshiach comes? The whole concept of Moshiach is that the spirit of folly will be removed from the earth. The spirit of evil.
Well, that's one viewpoint. My mind is viewpoint.
Another question. It's written, one of the proofs that Maimonides brings for the coming of Moshiach from the Torah is what? Is there in the Torah proof that Moshiach is going to come? Very hard to find a proof, right? What's the proof? There is one proof. One of the proofs is from that it's going to be, it's written that the cities of refuge. Right? What is a city of refuge made for? If I kill, if somebody, Mr. A, killed by accident Mr. B, he runs away to the city of refuge. There were only six cities of refuge in Jewish history. Supposed to be nine cities of refuge, another three in the other side of the Jordan. It never took place, right? Must be that we need, it never happened yet. It must, we know Moshiach is supposed to come and make it happen. Who needs, when Moshiach comes, who needs cities of refuge? Killing will be taking place when Moshiach comes. Why a person kills by mistake, you know? Because the person who was supposed to be killed was supposed to be killed. If not, he wouldn't die. But if everybody is righteous, nobody is... Who needs cities of refuge, for heaven's sake? Who needs sacrifices? Sin offerings? Who needs offerings? Talk about after the resurrection of the dead. That the answer is, after, let's say Moshiach comes tomorrow, we have generations of Jews who never brought a sin offering for all the sins that they made. They have to finish, they have to fulfill their obligations. For this we need sin offerings, not for new sins, you understand?
Temporary catch-up.
A temporary catch-up. Cities of refuge, all the guys who by mistake killed over the last 2,000 years, they need to run somewhere. They need to atone. City of refuge is an atonement. A style of an atonement, you're being exiled. It's an atoning for taking a life. That for the people who did it throughout exile, they need it. But the moment that will be done, for sure will not need a sin offering. Then even if it's going to be sin offering, it will be a temporary thing until we make it all the way there. But the moment it's be resurrection of the dead, it'll be the sin offering. Who is a sin? Nobody is a sin.
Doesn't Maimonides agree that the world's going to be the same? Human nature's still going to be the same?
Yeah, tell me. Resurrection of the dead is the same.
That's supernatural.
And Maimonides agrees with the resurrection of the dead, right?
He does, but what human nature is going to be like?
Well, forget about them. There's almost an in-building contradiction within Maimonides' world. He said it's not going to change, everything will be the same. Just people be resurrected. Really? That's it? Yeah. Just a little thing.
It's just going to be
the a little moment. Just the same guys. Then you see a gay governor coming out from the grave. Hi, Rabbi Yankel, how are you? Oh, everything is good. Let's go out for dinner.
It's called the new normal.
The new normal. We will not have any more children after the resurrection of the dead. Life will not be, food will not be the main thing. People will be able to live without food. Food would be like a luxury or something that you do.
Well, that's not Maimonides' view.
What I mean to say, even according to Naim, the moment you talk about resurrection of the dead, nothing is normal. Right? And he says, oh, and the lion will be the wolf. What does this mean?
Depends on whether it's literal or metaphorical.
No, not metaphorical, what does it mean?
That's not Maimonides.
What Maimonides says, metaphorical means what? What?
World peace.
World peace, very normal, right? The whole world, everybody will get along. Very normal, sure. The normal of Maimonides is the biggest miracle. Let's finish it. We are on page 14, 16.
On the second day, you shall offer a male goat without blemish for a sin offering. They shall cleanse the altar by sprinkling blood as they cleansed it with the blood of the bull. When you have finished cleansing it with the goat's blood, you shall offer a young bull without blemish and a ram from the flock without blemish. You shall offer them before God, and the priest shall cast salt upon them, and they shall offer them up for a burnt offering to God. For, for 7 days, you shall prepare every day a goat for a sin offering as you did on the second day. They shall also prepare a young bull and a ram from the flock without blemish. For 7 days shall they make atonement for the altar and purify it. Thus they shall consecrate it. They shall complete these 7 days, and then from the 8th day onwards the priest shall offer upon the altar your burnt offerings and your peace offerings, and I will be pleased with you, said God Almighty God.
That's the best thing. I will be pleased with you.